Hello, dreamers, and welcome back to another transmission of the Dreaming Addict podcast with your host, Mariana Manuela Vasquez. Today's topic is literature. More specifically, we're going to be talking about a young girl's dream of becoming a writer. She is one of her followers, and she has sent me her short story, which I'm going to read to you today. She has chose to remain anonymously, but let me tell you, this story is very, very good, so it's worth hearing it. Here we go. Taming a Heart of Fire. Once upon a time, in a magical land far, far away, there was a little girl named Talonia. The country where she lived in was called a Zanvac. It had whimsical forests and delicious fruits, housed fantastical creatures and beautiful views. It had very snowy mountains and rainforest fountains. Located on the land's corner, it had access to two blue coasts and colorful creatures within. This land suffered from a danger called the Dark Storm, which brought to the country chimeras and monsters. These events did not only stroke the animals and plants, but they also affected humans, as our girl Talonia. With a spark on her fingernails and electricity running through her veins, Talonia could feel something awakening on her. She had a power over fire. She could ignite it, she could control it, and she could burn anything she wanted. Her best friend and adoptive sister Fuchsia was affected in a different way. She grew blue skin, turning her hands into webbed paws, while her ears grew blue pointy fins. She could also feel a power inside of her. It was malleable and it changed with time. It was sometimes present and sometimes missing. These events had occurred when Talonia was 15 years old. And now, 3 years later, she and her adoptive sister have found themselves in Shack, living a day-to-day common life. They stayed in the forests fighting night creatures if necessary, and collecting bloomberries or hunting silverhead monkeys by day. Her sister accompanied Talonia when she isolated herself from the town, in fear she could burn it all to the ground. It was very few the towns she could visit, because as a lost girl, she stayed following the sounds of the green-colored grounds. This fire girl was debating with herself each and every day, "Who am I?" Memories from her past haunted her, planting more fear inside of her. She saw flames, screams, and she could feel sadness in her dreams. She was terrified, and that is why she locked all and every one of her memories and powers deep into her soul. Wandering one day in the Alluria forests, the sisters were discussing how Fuchsia's powers had disappeared shortly after her 25th birthday. She missed her powers and needed them to power their hometown's water source. She needed them back. "It's funny," they say. Well, one sister wanted to have her powers gone, the other one wanted to use them. Suddenly, an idea came to Fuchsia's mind. Hey, I just remembered something. Last Tuesday, while I collected berries with Gizora, she told me that Eliki had helped one of her friends with a dark magic disease. Makunga, I presume. She told me Eliki is a witch doctor. Maybe they can help us with our little magic issue. "Do you really think so?" said Talonia doubtingly. Fuchsia gave her a big sympathetic smile and a comfortable pat in the back, and said, "Well, it's worth giving it a try." And off they went to seek Eliki's help, the sorcerer known to control all four elements, and perhaps help Talonia to control her powers. Gizora guided them throughout the woods and over the rivers. She, with her moss turtle back and big brown eyes, had traveled through all of Zanvac, and maybe even further. Over 150 years old, this little smart pet of hers had a big heart and loved helping others. She got stuck with the sisters as if they were her children. Yelling at the sky and looking for a place to rest, Gizora signaled to where the cave was located. Up in the south's floaty mountains, there was a cave, a crystal cave, in fact. They climbed through the lianas and reached the rock and stone formation. The sisters entered the cave in the mountain, frightened by the dark magic it irradiated, but feeling safe for the tales of Eliki's help. These mysterious caves were made out of two-use crystals, glowing with colored lights. The deeper they were in the cave, the bigger the crystals and the brighter they shined. As they were walking in, Talonia calls out the sorcerer's name multiple times. She heard nothing. Fuchsia called out their name, but no response either. They gave each other a look of disappointment, deciding on what to do next. The sisters, disappointed on their aide's disappearance, were heading out of the crystal caves. Fuchsia gasped sharply, and it seemed as if the crystals have sucked her into darkness. Thelonia turned around quickly, her heart beating loud and clear. Nothing else was heard but her breathing, changing, and her feet stumbling backwards. "Fuchsia?" she whispered in fear. Her mind was creating the worst scenarios on her head. Was she lost? Is Aliki here? She wondered. Out of the blue came the sorcerer from the black. "Hello there," a deep rusty voice said from behind her ear. She mumbled in the witch's name to make sure it was them, and moved slowly forward with frightened eyes and looked at the owner of that dreadful voice. A teen with flowers on their long hair and green details around their head and clothing showed them off as a beautiful fairy. The voice took her out of her amusement and back into reality. With a broken voice, she managed to say, "You're Aliki, aren't you? My sister and I came here for your help. Pardon me, we have disturbed you." The sorcerer enlarged their neck and moved closer to the intruder. With green sparkles around, their bodies circled around Thelonia. The magical creature laughed loudly on her face. The echo did not help make this any easier for the fire girl. "Oh, sweetie, how do you think your presence could disturb me? You are the key, after all," answered Aliki. A confused Thelonia asked many questions, and a proud Aliki answered them all. "Look into my eyes, child," roared the witch. She did as told and stared into their bright emerald eyes. The crystal's glow disappeared, and there was nothing else to see but darkness and two supernatural creatures submitted into each other's eyes. The dreams Thelonia was so afraid for conquered her mind. All the burned memories bombarded her with melancholic feelings. She saw it all. When she was 5, her house was up in flames, blue and green from all the colors but red. Doors opening between the smoke, big wings flapping and screams that cried for help. 2 gentle hands and a kiss on the forehead, a sweet I love you, and she was riding off on a horse's back. Disoriented, Thelonia fainted to the ground. She saw flames on her hands going up her arms and into her eyes. "So now you see, baby, you're my key to power. You will give me all I need to be the queen I deserve to be, and own the now forgotten ancient crown." Thelonia ran away afraid of what she had just saw, what she had just learned. Tripped and fell from the cave into Gizora's arms. As soon as Gizora learned from everything that had happened, she gave the girl a strong hug, raised her chin, and said, "It's time for you to visit your parents." Thelonia's eyes opened wide. She mumbled, questioning her friend, and said, "My parents? What are you talking about?" With a broken voice, she whispered, "Do you know them?" Gizora looked down and then said, "There is no time for explanations. We have to get you to Ashworld right now." Thelonia and Gizora walked away from the cave and the other mountains where they sat in front of a purple river. "Miss Thelonia, you have to connect with who you are. You have to get to your ash past." Thelonia had been terrorized by her hunting dreams for too long, so it was time that she confronted them. She closed her eyes and remembered every little moment where her fears were awakened and the flames screamed her name. She went through a vortex filled with visions. She focused on her memories. 2 beautiful people flew away from a burning house and landed beside her. They were her parents. Herrera and Shinburn explained to her how she came from a long line of ancient phoenixes and her powers were of the most powerful kind. They also said that the horse was a ghost they sent to Fuchsia's house in search of protection. They told her that they loved her and that she had to believe in herself. As she woke up, the tears dried quickly on her phoenix skin. Thelonia's life was clearer than before. She knew what she had to do. Her eyes turned bright orange and her wings slapped the air. The flames on them could have burned it all. But Thelonia was in synchrony with her heart, and she had tamed the flame to her own will. She flew to Aliki's caves and enlightened its darkness with her wings. Aliki's plan had succeeded. They wanted Thelonia to be motivated by Fuchsia's kidnapping in order to reveal her true self. They were looking for her ancient magic, the most powerful of all, in order to absorb it and claim a Sanvec's lost kingdom. "I knew you could do it! Kidnapping your sister was the key for your powers. and now they're all mine. As the witch attacked the fire girl with all four elements at the same time, Thelonia stayed still, calmed. Her voice echoed as if she talked with a thousand people's voices. You are no opponent to us. You are nothing but a bastard of evil. My light will cure your wrongs, so now I banish you from this world. Forever. The sorcerer had fell down in weakness and was burned down when Thelonia raised her wings and allowed for all hell to break loose on her parents' murderer. She landed gracefully, happy that all evil was vanished and that light would prevail. Later on, Fuchsia came out of the darkness and splashed some water on her sister's face. They laughed and Thelonia congratulated her for finally accessing her powers. It just took for me to get a little frightened, but I got them. No, answered Thelonia, it took for you to be brave. So to end this tale and enjoy our days, I tell you that Thelonia transformed into the powerful creature she was meant to be. Fuchsia's powers came back and I could say they just lived happily like that. But the sisters liked danger, and Gisora liked to help. So in joining the three fates, a curious hero group was there to collaborate. And that's how the story ends. I have to say, I really like this short story. I love the way that it is written and the dialogue and how the descriptions of each scene are made. It makes it really vivid. I would please like to ask you all to share all of your love and send all of your good comments to our anonymous writer to encourage her to write more. Because I think she should. She is giving us very good material and very good stories that the world deserves to know. I would like to know also your opinion on the story and what other story would you like to hear from. That is all for today's Dreaming Addict podcast transmission, and I will see you in the next one, dreamers. Goodbye.